I want to conclude today my discussion of Julius Caesar. I've been focusing on the issue of tyranny and potential tyranny, and now I want to turn to the overthrowing of tyranny. I want to turn to the two main characters of the whole play, Brutus and Cassius, and ask the question of why did their plot fail? It's a little bit of a lesson here, even in a strange way, for the GOP. Why is it that an attempt to subvert tyranny does not succeed? Well, the plot begins with Cassius. He's the conniver, he's the Machiavellian, he's the organizer of the conspiracy. And remember, all conspiracies need stealth, they need organization, they need somebody who realizes this is what needs to be done, and I'm going to do what's necessary to make it happen. Now, that's Cassius. But interestingly, Cassius does not think he can carry out the plot by himself, even though he's a very resourceful guy. He needs Brutus. And so he goes to Brutus, and he, in the opening scenes, he's talking Brutus into joining the conspiracy. Brutus is initially reluctant, but then agrees. Now, what is the value of Brutus to the conspiracy? Well, it is that Brutus has a public reputation, and he has a public reputation for virtue. He is known to be a man who cares about Rome. He will not do things for his private interest. He's not motivated by envy or anything petty. This is a man of a noble family, of noble sentiments. And so Brutus is necessary because he will give public dignity to this assassination. Let's remember, even at the end of the play, Mark Antony gives a tribute to Brutus. And this is after the war in which Brutus is killed. Brutus commits suicide. This was the noblest Roman of them all. All the conspirators, save only he, did that they did in envy of great Caesar. He only, in a general honest thought and common good to all, made one of them. So Antony's saying Brutus was motivated only by a concern for Rome. Brutus loves virtue, and he's a straightforward guy. But his very virtue, and this is the key point, his very virtue leads him to make many tactical mistakes. Why? Because he's not Machiavellian. He thinks that if you do the right thing and you explain the right thing that you did and you, in a sense, behave like a gentleman in the way that you present your case to the Romans, all will be well. But nothing could be further from the truth. Brutus makes, as I say, a series of errors. There are about seven of them, and virtually all of them are made over Cassius's objection. I really want to focus on just two. Here's Cassius. I'm now quoting from the text. They're organizing the conspiracy, and they're trying to get more people to their side. Brutus is now, by this time, already in. Here's Cassius. But what of Cicero? Shall we sound him? I think he will stand very strong with us. Brutus. Oh, name him not. Let us not break with him, for he will never follow anything that other men begin. So Cassius wants the silver tongue of Cicero, the famous orator of Rome, and a strong opponent of Caesar, who undoubtedly would have helped the conspiracy and would have helped to explain it to the Roman people. But Brutus writes him off and basically goes, well, if it's not his idea, he's not going to want to do it. So they don't even sound him out, as Cassius wants to do. Here's the second suggestion, again from Cassius. Brutus vetoes it, and you can see how this is a fatal error on Brutus's part. Cassius is right, and Brutus is wrong. Here's Cassius. I think it is not meet, meet here means fit, that Mark Antony, so well beloved of Caesar, should outlive Caesar. And then a few lines later, let Antony and Caesar fall together. So here is Cassius wisely suggesting, let's get Caesar and let's get Antony. That way we root out the tyranny. We take out the big tyrant and we take out the little tyrant who is his sidekick. Here's Brutus. Our course will seem to bloody Caius Cassius to cut the head off and then hack the limbs. Let's be sacrificers, but not butchers, Caius. So Brutus doesn't want to kill them both. He goes, let's just get Caesar. We don't need Antony. Well, think of what a disastrous mistake this turns to be. Antony, in a sense, becomes the new apostle of Caesarism. Antony ultimately takes the Caesarist model, which is to ally the one, Antony, with the people, the many, to now overthrow the Senate and the aristocracy and establish Caesarism in Rome. The message here that we're getting is that a degree of Machiavellianism is necessary to succeed in politics. In other words, you need virtue, you need Brutus, but you also need Cassius. And it's Brutus's overriding of Cassius that shows really the key to why the plot fails. Now, notice the Machiavellianism of Mark Antony. This is from the famous speech of Mark Antony over Caesar's dead body. And he's speaking to the Roman people. He's speaking of Caesar. He had brought many captives home to Rome, whose ransom did the general coffers fill. Did this in Caesar seem ambitious? So Antony's trying to convince the Roman people Caesar's not ambitious. He goes, he has all these conquests, he got all this booty and all this money, he came back and he donated it to the state. Does that sound like it's ambition to you? And the answer is, yes, it does. That is what a public man will do to sort of win over the people. No, it's not private ambition, but of course it's public ambition. Let's continue with Antony. When the poor have cried, Caesar hath wept. Ambition should be made of sterner stuff. So Anthony's saying, when the poor people are suffering and crying, here's Caesar. Oh, I'm really sorry you're in this condition. Now, what is this? This is tactical tears. This is the Democratic Party. This is moist eyes. Oh, the people unemployed, the people suffering. But of course, the Democrats are only concerned about accumulating power for themselves. So what we're talking about here is the Machiavellianism of pretending to public sympathy, when in reality, Caesar's life is not the same as the life of the poor guy. You all did see that on the Lupercal I thrice presented him a kingly crown, which he did thrice refuse. Was this ambition? Yes, this is ambition. Why? Because Caesar knew that in the old days, when the Tarquin kings, who were foreign kings, ruled Rome, they wore kings on their heads. They wore crowns on their heads, and the Roman people hated them, and they drove out the Tarquin kings. And so Caesar realized, I can't literally put a crown on my head. I can't call myself king, so I want all the power of the king without seeming to be a king. So that is the cunning of Caesarism. Basically, what's going on is that tyrannical power is being established in Rome, but it's being established in disguise. It's being established while keeping the old forms. Oh yeah, Rome is still a republic. We don't use the word king around here. Stop calling me a king. Take away this crown. This is unseemly. Caesar wants the power of the monarchy without the name of the monarch. And so the lesson for us from the play, and also a political lesson for us, is that in fighting the dirty game of politics, particularly against Machiavellian opponents, is yes, we are the party of virtue, and we should be. That's in the end what we're fighting for. But virtue admixed with a certain degree of tactical wisdom, with a certain degree of, you may say, Machiavellianism, that's the way that you actually win on the ground.